Hello everyone, I'm Drewmatth and today I'm going to present you a complete Season 8 Taliyah guide. For credentials, I've reached last season a maximum of 100 points in Master on Europe, Nordic and East. In this video, we will talk about Summoner Spells, all combinations, Runes, all trees, Builds, what item paths to follow and how to use the new AP items, Abilities, how to use her spells and what they do, what is the max order of abilities, what is her win condition, how to win games with Taliyah, how to slow push or hard push and more, lane phase versus mid game versus late game, when Taliyah shines, what are her power spikes, combos and tricks, what are her main combos, how to use Comet versus how to use Eerie, circle management, how to properly position in your queues, wall ultimates, how to cast properly your ult and when to cast it, when to engage versus when to poke in teamfights, champions Taliyah synergizes well with, champions which Taliyah does not synergize well with, matchups, hardest matchups and skill matchups, and finally, video resources that I've used in this video with links. The summoner spells I recommend for ranked games are either Heal Flash, Ignite Flash, Cleanse Flash or Exhaust Flash. Heal is most used at higher levels because of the 2 vs 2 trades that often tend to happen on mid lane between you and your jungler and the enemy. This is the safest summoner spell to pick for Taliyah because it also gives a small movement speed burst that allows us to escape some scenarios. Beware, do not use it when Ignite was used on you because the effect will be halved. Use it right before you think the all-in combo with Ignite will come on you for maximum effectiveness. Ignite is used mostly by the players who want to climb solo queue fast and they know they are above their current league. Pro players used it before and it works because when we play against enemy below our level, we can afford going for kills in lane and Ignite will help us achieve this goal. Obviously, Ignite counters heal by applying the heal reduction, so use this against Soraka, Vladimir and other champions that heal themselves or others quickly. I use Cleanse in the matchups that have a targeted strong CC, such as Twisted Fate, Annie or against junglers that have the same abilities, long range CCs. Beware, Mazahar ult and Warwick ult are suppression abilities and cannot be removed by Cleanse. I use Exhaust in matchups that require a damage reduction ability. Exhaust makes the enemy deal 40% less damage for a short period, so it is most useful in the Katarina and Zed matchups and some others. I rarely use Barrier Flash because heal is generally better than barrier and barrier blocks less damage of Ignite because of the short duration. The fact that you can save someone else from certain death with heal also helps. I will present 6 different combinations of 3 major keystone runes. Obviously, if you find something that works better for you than what I present, keep using it. The tree that I like to use most is the Arcane Comet tree presented here. It uses Mana Flow Band to ensure we keep mana levels afloat, Celerity for extra movement speed, and Scorch for some extra damage. The secondary tree uses Stopwatch, which now even nerfed, it is still the best rune in that tree, almost feeling like a real keystone, and Minion Dematerializer, which in my opinion is another extremely strong rune. This rune should be used 4 times on melee minions, 1 time on casters, and 1 time on cannons to ensure maximum push power. Stopwatch now has a 10 minute cooldown, but it is still a free zone at level 7, 8 or 9 depending on how far ahead we are. Another tree for secondary could be Precision tree with Presence of Mind and Coup de Grace. Use the secondary tree if you feel that GLP is not providing enough mana for your spammy needs. An alternative general tree is exactly the same as this, but with the Eerie Keystone. Most players use this keystone because they do not want to complicate their combos. Theoretically, Arcane Comet later on deals more damage than Eerie and until mid game deals on average the same damage. The only trick that you need to know if you're playing Arcane Comet is that you are not supposed to hit W first before proccing it. The rune needs to be procced by Q or E first so you don't miss it. Eerie requires some dancing around targets with Q and auto attacks on cooldown. Both runes are good and it is just a matter of preference, but I do feel that later on Arcane Comet becomes stronger. We'll talk about these 2 runes later on and how to use them. Another set of runes that I think for some it might be viable and interesting is Glacial Augment. I will present here two trees, one focused on potion regeneration and biscuits, and the other on cooldown reduction and minion dematerializer. We are also interested in mana flow band and celerity from sorcery tree. In theory, the arcane comet tree should be used when you want to spam Qs from a distance on the target without getting too close to them, versus any perhaps rise or talon, etc. And the eerie tree against targets that you can auto attack so you can proc it more often. For items, we will start with the classic Doran plus 2 pots, and then we will move towards either GLP or Ludens based on preference. I recommend GLP simply because it provides a slow active that helps the player on hitting his main combo. If you are not liking this item, you can always try Ludens for some extra push power, but still, in my opinion, the best in-slot first item is GLP. If you have mana problems, go for Presence of Mind. If you still have mana problems, get Arcane Juice stuff. Next on the list is Sorcerer's Boots. If you feel you don't reach the cooldown reduction you like to play with, go for Lucidity Boots. Third item is Liandry's. With the new patch, Liandry deals now a percent of max health and also increases our damage, so it is ideal as a third item for us. Fourth item is a matter of preference, mostly, but with the latest buffs I recommend going Rabidons. Fifth item would be Void Staff for the extra magic penetration, and last item is a matter of choice between Riley, Zonia or Banshees. Riley is used in the games you need extra kite, Zonia when they target you too much or you simply die to the nasty assassins, Banshees when you need extra magic resist and a spell shield versus a Skarner for example. In some matchups, besides needing stopwatch, you might also need Zonia as a first item or Banshee. I do not really pick them as a first item right now, but more as a secondary or such, because I feel that without the main source of mana, Taliyah doesn't function that well. In some cases, you can also buy only parts of an item. Heavy AP assassin matchups go just for a Negatron cloak or something else that provides magic resist, but not an entire item. Morello is another situational item that we are interested to use against champions with heavy heals such as Vladimir, Soraka and more. Another interesting item to keep in mind is Spellbinder, but I do not see yet how to fit it in the build, perhaps as a 4th, 5th or last item, but certainly not before Boots, GLP and Liandry's. Here is the theoretical full build. Don't forget to switch to Red Trinket at level 9 and to get elixirs when you are full build. Buy at least 2 pink wards per game and place them strategically at the entrances of your jungle so you protect yourself from potential ganks. Taliyah is a pretty difficult champion in terms of abilities. Besides knowing when to do a good ultimate just like Bard, we also have to learn how to hit our main CC spell, W, how to keep track of Q circles so we don't destroy our combo, and we also have to remember that we need to stick to walls to trigger our passive. Let's jump to abilities now and see what they do. Her passive allows us to surf on a wall, so when we are not in combat, we need to stick to walls to reach our destination faster. For example, when coming from base to mid or when roaming and so on. Her Q fires 5 rocks at the target if you are not on a worked ground or circle. If you are on a circle, you will fire only 1 rock at the target and you will have half mana cost refunded. Her Q is an area of effect spell, so it can target multiple people if they are very close. Her work ground or circle has a duration of about 120 seconds before it disappears. Taliyah also gains a small movement speed while you are on the circle, so it's best to put your circle near your tower in lane phase and to stay towards them so you get the extra movement speed on escapes. The main strategy is to stick in and out of the circles like a dance to gain the maximum movement speed and also to cast Qs from non-circled areas. However, if you spend this ability on non-circles, you will find out that you don't have any wave clear besides E, so there is more to this discussion on the table. We will talk about Q circle management later on. Her W is a displacement spell that moves towards your chosen direction all targets in that small circle area. Her E is a spell that generates 18 boulders that slow and damage enemies on the first cast, and after a short delay they explode, dealing some more damage to the enemies that are caught. These boulders trigger dashes, jumps and so on, but not blinks or flashes. Her ultimate allows us to create a wall, a long-range zone that should usually block the enemy from escaping or to divide objectives. In order to cast it but not to ride it, simply press R. To ride the wall, you have to press R twice in quick succession. So press R once and then press it once again in the next second to ride it. If you press it again after the wall has deployed, you will destroy it. So be careful when trapping teammates by accident, and this is another thing that we have to be aware of. We first want to max out R, then Q, then E, then W. Before I move to the win condition, I want to state that her main combos are Q, W, E, Q or Q, E, W, Q depending on cases. We will further discuss these combos later on, but because I talk about pushing in this next section, we require a basic knowledge of those at least. The main pushing combo should be W on melee minions towards the casters, followed quickly by E and Q. Taliyah as an early game champion is determined to get kills because she needs to dictate the pace of the game in the first 25 minutes. Her scaling into late game is not great, but now with the new Liandry item there is more room for debate simply because of that max HP damage. Her main problem was that magic resist stacking champions later on nullified her. Another huge problem for Taliyah mains later on is her ultimate in teamfights. When there is a teamfight that is not nearby an objective, her ultimate becomes extremely difficult to cast because there are a lot of variables and a lot of stuff that can go seriously wrong. The main tactics later on would be to try to split their carries from their tank, but the easiest way is to try to do a Baron or an Elder or an Inner Tower with the help of her wall, so you trap enemies away from it. Her win condition lies in her early game. If she dies once or twice early on but does not lose a huge amount of CS, she still has a chance, but if she loses that CS fight and is behind at least 20 or 30 or 40 CS, the game is pretty much over, at least from the mid lane point of view, and you need to hope that your team carries you. Win conditions can be divided in two groups, the win you want on lane phase and the win you want on the entire game. The lane phase win condition is simple. Try to kill the enemy mid laner until 6 if the skill matchup allows, or try to push post 6 with spells and minion dematerializer and move bottom or top to get your team some advantage by objective or kills. Her ultimate can also be casted to help your jungler when he is requiring that. If your team consists of a hyper carry such as Kog'Maw, Twitch, Vayne, Tristana or any other champion that fits this role, your general win condition becomes to feed this target with your ganks. You should always pass kills to these champions because they ensure a good transition into the late game. Even if your team does not have a hyper carry, your main idea should be not to feed yourself too much but also others, the ones who can output damage at least on par with you in the late game. The transition from early to mid game should be smooth. A first small power spike is enabled when you get the first part of GLP, Lost Chapter, and also her rank 1 ult at level 6. This item gives us enough mana to actually be capable of roams. Her second power spike starts after we finish Liandry. If you are a bit ahead, this item will ensure the maximum damage potential for our game. The last power spike is after you finish 3rd or 4th items, depending on how far we are ahead, if we are. In the lane phase, be extremely careful of the champions that can gank at level 2, such as Jarvan, Pantheon, Vi, Shaco and most infuriating, Twitch. Ward above topside bush so you can cover jungle entrances before you are level 3. Stick to the warded side for extra safety. Obviously, if you know where the enemy jungle started, ward the expected zone of gank. You can notice that especially in lower elos by champions that are returning to lane, such as bot, versus champions that are already on a lane, such as a top laner, and this means the enemy jungler started on the bottom side, for example. Most matchups for Taliyah are skill matchups. This can be determined by the fact that her abilities are all skill shots. Because of this, Taliyah is pretty hard to learn for beginners. This can be noticed by statistic of players who played under 50 games versus players that played more than 200. In the beginning, when you pick her up, I recommend to play safer on lane, because most lane opponents will feel tough. I also recommend to ward and just to keep afloat on CS levels. Try to keep the lane nearby your tower and either form a slow push by leaving the 3 caster minion alive outside of the turret range, or keep the lane at middle and just instant combo push and rush bot at 6 if the game allows. You are theoretically supposed to roam first, and also you are supposed to reach the lane first. In your first 20 games, perhaps you will do some mistakes such as stepping over warded zones, casting your ult bad, getting caught by the enemy jungler and creating an unfavorable 3v3, getting caught by the enemy mid laner or simply doing a bad roam. This is okay and understandable, so you just have to practice and it will naturally come to you later on. The advanced Taliyah players would want to get kills on lane because now they understand their kit and their push power. They know when and where and at what level they want to dictate the lane phase. And then they will know which is the right time to roam, to engage, to poke and so on. Taliyah's game win condition can be determined either by catching someone with your wall or W, securing an objective with your wall that offers the required advantage, or to force a teamfight with her wall by separating the enemy team in an awkward position. As you can see, she has different win conditions based on situations, but you should try to avoid late game teamfights that are not surrounded by objectives by all means. As I stated before, the main pushing combo you would want is W on melee minions towards the casters, quickly followed by E and Q. You can also do it by pushing the casters into melee in the reverse way. Taliyah has two main combos that aren't that much different. These combos, however, are mostly used in different situations. The main combos are QWEQ, or simply WEQ, for a surprise W in lane phase into E, and QEWQ or EWQ for a more predictable combo but easier to hit. Using E first, we practically tell the opponent, look, I might W next, but having the slow from the spell makes it easier to land our W. Hitting W first in E deals theoretically less damage, but it is less telegraphed and a bit harder to hit since we don't have a slow already on the target. If you play with GLP, we would like first to hit the target with it, so the combo would be GLP WEQ or QGLP WEQ or again QGLP EWQ, but I'd rather hit first W with the GLP combo as the slow is already applied. Which combo to use when, you ask? I will talk about these combos now without including GLP, but you should always use it if it's not on cooldown. If you use Ludens, it's even simpler. First, the WE combo should be used on lane when the target is already slowed or CC'd by someone else, or when you don't want to get too close to the target. Using E first, then going for the W implies two things: that he will know that you are going to cast W, and that he will know that you will come closer first, if you repeat it often. A Taliyah main will never use only one combo in a game, because this way the opponent will know what to expect, so we have to use mostly our WE combos. And when we go for kills, rarely, we have to use EW combo. Try to use EW combo when the opponent does not have flash to ensure the kill. When you use W first and you know you've missed, you can skip using E to stop consuming extra mana. There is a second window in which you have time. When you use E first and the enemy left the pellets, you can skip using W to stop consuming extra mana. I recommend for a Taliyah beginner to play 10 or 15 minutes a day in practice tool to understand these two combos and to spam them there. The Eerie vs Comet discussion is an interesting topic and I don't take sides on either. Personally, I play with Arcane Comet, but both are theoretically the best main runes for Taliyah. There is a substantial difference on playing with those runes and the main combos are different. For Eerie, we are interested in coming in and out of the fight with auto attacks to proc it more often, and with Comet we are interested in hitting Q first to proc it, then going for the full combo. Until mid game, both runes deal an approximately close amount of damage if you have at least 55% hit rate with Comet. Later on, Arcane Comet deals more because it has a larger damage potential and has an area of effect zone, and also because in teamfights we don't have that much time to go in and out and would just rather throw it there by using Q. I've tested both in numerous games and liked Comet more simply for the reason that in lane phase I don't have to get close to champions that I don't want to, such as Talon, Cassio and more. The only problem with Comet comes when you catch someone off guard with WE combo and you simply miss it, but that's a rare case and even more rare Eerie gets you the kill there. I recommend to try both. With Eerie, you have to switch between Qs and auto attacks often get maximum damage, while Comet allows you to play safer in lane and still deal some comparable damage, possibly less but still meaningful later on. The only difference with Comet is that you have to either use E first to proc Comet and W, which will hit, or if you do the WE combo, just hit Q before. There is also the Glacial Augment rune, which you are supposed to auto attack first, then use your full combo. I don't recommend Glacial Augment simply because you lose somewhere between 1000 to 3000 damage each game by using one of the other two runes. Don't forget that your Q creates a movement speed bonus area. These zones can be used to create better escape routes, so try to cast your Qs in the zones in which you have wards on lane phase so you can follow easier to escape paths. As a trick, her ultimate can be casted in melee range to escape the sticky enemies that chase you. Use this as an ultimate means to escape because the cooldown is rather large and you would better use it on ganks or objectives if you are not certain that you will escape. With time, this tool becomes more and more useful. Remember also to stick to walls with her passive. A lot of people, myself included, always forget about the extra movement speed that is tremendously useful. Another trick that you would want to learn is to flash mid Q for a surprise chunk of damage on a low HP target. You simply move in the direction that you want and instantly flash after one or two pellets. A different, fun thing to do as a Taliyah is to try to predict W's, as I've shown in multiple videos and even in this one. A smart thing to do after trapping the enemy bot lane with a wall is to expect a flash. If you expect the flash, then you know that you can W under the zone where you think they will flash. Generally, they will flash to pass the wall. This is perhaps one of the most satisfying things to do as a Taliyah main. Before I start this section, I want to reference the 3 Taliyah tips video at the resources section at the end. In that video, I talk a little about circle management and how to position properly, and it is worth to check for further reading. By definition, circle management is practically how to use and manage your Q. Every Q you use generates a circle underneath that does not allow you to use the big Q again until the circle is over. By big Q, I refer to the Q that shots 5 pellets. The small Q is the Q that fires only one pellet on a circle. Generally, we are interested in creating a safe zone nearby our tower to get that sweet movement speed to escape ganks easier. However, we don't want to spam Q because that will create a zone that will not allow us to push at all further on. A Taliyah main should try to learn when is the proper time to use Q and when it is not. I recommend to keep only a side of the lane nearby your ward filled with Q circles so you have an escape route and the other side to be used for engaging purposes or when your jungler ganks. Never engage if you see you don't have space for full Q, unless you don't need full Q. If it is necessary to get a kill, flash out of the circle for a full instant Q. I've noticed when I coach some players before that there are generally two types of mistakes that are being done. One is not using Q too much, having too much mana always, which is an extremely safe playstyle, but you might lose CS or you will simply die because you did not set the safe zones that offer extra movement speed. Also, playing extremely passive in lane is not really the Taliyah way unless the opponent is always on top of your head or simply trades better or plays a more aggressive champion. The second mistake that I've seen is using too many Qs and practically being out of mana all the time. There should be a constant balance between how many circles you have down, what is your mana status, and how much damage you can deal in an effective time. I recommend the middle way. Have enough space to engage, but also enough room for escape using the movement speed. You can also use small Qs to farm the cannons or to farm more simply because it refunds half of the mana and it does not refresh the circle duration. All in all, you should neither spam too much your Q nor too little. You should try to keep the lane at the middle so at 6 you can freely push and roam bot. You should jump in and out of the circles constantly gaining movement speed and using full Qs for poke or kills when allowed. Guys in higher elo know how to stay behind minions so your full Q won't hit that much, but poking with a small Q and proccing your rune is also worth. There is also a trick that you can use with minion dematerializer. You use it on the last cannon or melee minion of a wave and you get a full Q on the enemy. The same works also when the enemy is hidden behind two caster minions and you can kill them with the first two or three pellets with your Q and hit the enemy champion with the rest. Wall ultimates. This section will be short because there is simply too much to talk about in a single video. I've already made on my channel a video that is quite exhaustive of the ways you can use your ultimate. It will be presented at the resources section at the end for further enhancing your knowledge. You will mostly use her ultimate either for roaming or splitting teamfights or teams from objectives. Here are the two maps that I've carried around since a year and a half ago when I wrote the LoL King guide. In these maps with red, we can notice the walking path that we are supposed to follow, and with green, the path of the wall. These maps do not include the new roaming strategies using the blast cones. I do not actually recommend to follow those blindly, because in most games you will have different things to take care of on the path, such as vision wards and perhaps even enemy champions. Understanding how to gank as a Taliyah requires experience, just like Twisted Fate and Aurelion's Soul, so you should not give up if you fail early on. I've failed countless times and I'm still doing bad ultimates sometimes, so it's okay. I've detailed in the other video three main types of ults and some other examples. The first is the ganking ult when you go bot and you try to either trap the enemy, get a kill or an objective. The second is the teamfight ult when you divide the teamfight to separate carries from tanks or support from carries. And the third is the type of ult that is used for objective control, towers, drakes, barons, you name it. Her ultimate can be used to block access to these certain zones and objectives, and it's extremely useful if used correctly. Please refer to the video for 50 plus example and cases. Taliyah has a lot of useful poke and also the ability to engage in some fights, but when to engage and when to poke? Normally, advanced Taliyah players should try to position somewhere far away from their team and should try to split the enemy team as best as they can. However, this strategy can go wrong in a lot of ways and is not really recommended. I would suggest that a good tactic in teamfights, especially for beginners but also in general, is to stick with your team and try to poke as much as possible, then to hit a WE combo on one or two targets, using your ult after only to catch the ones who escape. It is generally best to avoid teamfights that are not nearby objectives. This could also work as a tip for general League of Legends playstyle, not just Taliyah. The ideal teamfight would consist of your team doing an objective, such as Baron, Drake or Tower, and using your wall before the enemy team could arrive to defend the objective. We can, from this point, either rush down the objective or poke with Q over the wall. This kind of teamfight maximizes Taliyah's true potential with her ultimate that generates turret. As stated somewhere before, Taliyah synergizes best with champions that are late game oriented. Taliyah loves the hyperscaling ADCs but does not really like early champions such as Ezreal or Lee Sin for jungle in her team composition. The reason behind this is the fact that she loses damage output in the late game, and without a jungler or an ADC or even a top laner that deals lots of damage later on, we risk losing the game by the fact that we have no damage at all. She also loves junglers that provide early CC but can also survive prolonged fights while doing some sort of damage, such as Rammus, Sejuani, Zac or even Jax or Warwick. She does not really like junglers like Shyvana or Master Yi because they are supposed to farm early on and they cannot provide the early game help for us and our team that we so much require as an early game champion. Rengar, Kha'Zix, fighters that output huge amounts of damage early but don't have major CC spells also work. Usually we are interested in junglers or supports that have some form of CC so they can enable our W. Avoid playing Taliyah with Maokai jungle because sometimes his spells will displace our target and we might lose an important 2 vs 2 fight early on. A good team comp for Taliyah would look like this: Bruiser top laner, tanky jungler, us, tanky support and hyperscaling ADC. A bad team comp for Taliyah would be tank top laner, early jungler without CC or scaling late game jungler, us, support that has no engage potential such as Soraka, and early game ADC. These are some general outlines if you want to know when it is the best time to actually pick Taliyah. Matchups. I will start this section by presenting hardest matchups in no particular order. Zed. This champion has been in top 5 in win rate for a very long time and for a very good reason. Now that stopwatch is at 10 minutes cooldown, he actually has time to use his ultimate once before it gets automatically denied by that item. We are interested in the Zed matchup to get exhaust or heal as a summoner spell and to reach for Zhonya for first or second item. If you think you can survive the matchup, you can go for a mana item early on, but I recommend Zhonya as soon as possible. His lane phase before level 6 is relatively close to yours, as in poke. Go back and wait for cooldowns and poke again. You should keep a safe distance from his W and try to trade with him and dodge as many Qs as possible. Post 6 you can either play it safe, push and roam, or try to fight him, but I do not recommend the second one. If you do get caught, try always to flash to towers in the moment his ultimate lands, right before he uses Q to get amplified damage. Use exhaust in the moment in which his ult lands on you and Zhonya right before he uses Q. You can notice his Q by his animation. try to get a grasp of that and how it works. Keep exhaust always in teamfights for him to deny some damage. This champion is usually banned in solo queue. Yasuo is perhaps one of the hardest matchups since he deals a lot of constant damage, and unlike a Cassiopeia who has a mana bar to take care of, his resources are limitless. I mostly ban Yasuo nowadays as a first ban because I can deal with Zed and Katarina, but I absolutely hate the Yasuo matchup. His kit counters pretty much of our kit. Our E does not deal that much damage to his dash, so it's not really reliable. Our Q gets easily countered by his W. The main point in this matchup is just to out roam. He will certainly follow, but he is predictable in dashes, so it's easier for your team to respond after you ganked. Your minions are his dash points, so he'll always have an idea of when he can reach you, so play accordingly. His Qs are dodgeable and you should try as much as you can, just sidestep when you see the animation. You should never get hit by his tornado post 6 because he will ult you. The tornado is much more simpler to dodge than his small Qs. Play with exhaust, heal or even barrier for his ultimate. Always think where he is on the map so he does not catch you off guard and sits on top of your head for the next 10 to 15 seconds. His follow potential is insane, so never get that close and just play safe in lane as much as you can. Ask for ganks if necessary and roam a lot. Try to get the kill with your jungler only when you are 100% certain that you will get the kill, so when you have a hard CC spell available, that is. Katarina. One of the harder matchups, but survivable with an early magic resist item such as Null Mantle or Negatron Cloak, and also exhaust for her ult. I started using Arcane Comet for this matchup simply because you can poke her from a distance without getting hit by her Q. When she does not have a dagger already set up on the ground, go and Q her, but stay far away from her daggers. Later on in teamfights, unless she is a very good player, she will struggle because of your exhaust and other CC spells from your teammates. Target her down and you should be okay if she was not overfed by this point. Her roaming potential is on par with yours minus the ultimate, so be extremely careful on both roaming and follow-ups on her roams. Never try to outplay a Katarina simply because of her dashes. Try also to get this champion banned because there are a lot of one-trick ponies that main her. Play relatively safe until 6, then try to do a good roam, but beware of the follow-up. You should roam only if your teammate will remain above 50% HP after your gank, so that when she follows, they would actually have a chance to survive and also Katarina would not get any reset. Azir. This matchup can be annoying, but you are not necessarily going to feed. Perhaps you might lose some CS, but in general you shouldn't be completely destroyed. Azir wins the trades mostly after level 3 because of his annoying Q spam and soldiers auto attacks, so if you feel oppressed, just try to push and roam bot. Get an early extra magic resist item if needed and also the magic resist rune from resolve and bone plating as secondary. In this matchup post 6 you have to be extremely careful for the insect dash ult combo that he will certainly try and he will probably get the kill on you if you don't have flash, so absolutely do not fight Fim unless you have it up. Heal could work good as a summoner spell in this matchup. Always stay away from CS as he will mostly put soldiers there to farm, so dodge his soldiers by not staying near your own CS. Soldier attacks will also trigger minions as far as I know, so you can abuse that. Kassadin is a matchup that is not so oppressive anymore because his Q now trigger minion aggro and the Q spam was our general problem. If possible, spam Q from a longer range and try to send him to base before 6. Post 6 there is no reason to fight him unless you have a hard CC such as Skarner, because he will always escape with blinks or even kill you. Kassadin is a good counter to Taliyah because if he does not have cooldown on teleport, he can easily follow you bot, so try to roam only when you know his teleport is not up. Kassadin's usefulness starts only at about level 11 and 2 items, so try to abuse early as much as you can and perhaps tell your team that too. I want to give you a reminder that for most of these matchups you can find full games on my channel. Some quick tips now against some classes of mid laners and specifics. Versus assassins such as Fizz, Akali, Diana, LeBlanc, Echo, Talon and others, where is possible, try to play aggressive. These assassins are skill matchups mostly and they are killable if you are careful with your planning. Versus Fizz, you can get advantage early on, you just have to be careful for his first ult now that stopwatch is at 10 minutes. Try to predict when is the moment that he will engage and dodge it. If he hits it on top of your head, he will deal less damage. Play safe post 6 until stopwatch is up or get an early magic resist item. In this matchup you can be extremely aggressive early on with your Qs. Just don't use auto attacks to trigger minions on you. Remember, his W will deal extra damage if you have his debuff on, so be careful around it. You can also get Zhonya if needed. Versus Akali or Diana, you can play aggressive pre-6 and then post-6 you have to play safe, and possibly get an extra magic resist item. LeBlanc is quite rare nowadays and can be quite oppressive. Roam if you feel that you get outplayed often. Versus Ekko, the main thing you have to do besides dodging Q and R is to stay away from his stuns and you are good to go. Talon must be kept at bay by long range Qs and should never be allowed to full engage on you from close range. Beware of his roaming potential also. Versus roamers such as Twisted Fate or Aurelion Sol, play with cleanse if you think their stun will help their jungler to get to you. Always ping versus Aurelion after level 3 that he is going to gank, and for Twisted Fate after level 6. Always expect a random teleport and if possible find the solutions and be the first to gank bot lane. You can win against Twisted Fate on lane but not so much against Aurelion. In these matchups you would want to win the push game, so I suggest playing with Ludens and Minion Dematerializer. Get all the push power you can and try to out push them. Versus Twisted Fate that should be doable but not so much versus Aurelion Sol. Always beware after you gank first that the enemy mid laner will follow. Always ping when they are missing from the lane and get a vision ward in the single bush that is in the river. That ward will ensure extra safety versus them. Try to clear their vision wards also all the time. This is perhaps the most entertaining of matchups because you have to play smarter on macros and not necessarily micros. Also think that when you gank bot they might respond with a roam top. The reverse also works, so definitely warn your team with pings. In long-range mages matchups such as Xerath, Ziggs, Vel'Koz or even Zoe, you have to try to understand their Q pattern and where they will cast it. You can go for cleanse versus Xerath and Zoe, but I do not really recommend it. I think heal in these matchups will be more useful. They will generally want to either poke you down to kill you or shove you out of the lane, but the matchup is not really impossible if you get boots and try to get close to them for a nice combo. Xerath is the most oppressive as his Qs bypass minions, but they are dodgeable if you always switch your dodge pattern. Try to be as non-predictable as possible. Get bone plating and +5 magic resist if needed to survive the lane phase. Post 6 try to either get close on them with your ult and outplay with flash or roam bot faster than them and get kills. They will follow with their long range abilities, but by the time they actually do something meaningful, you should have sealed the deal. Get minion dematerializer if you feel that in the matchup you don't have enough push power. These matchups are all about roaming and learning how to properly dodge their poke on lane. Hard CC or bursters such as Malzahar, Lissandra, Annie, Cassio, Syndra, Lux, Anivia or Veigar are also some annoying matchups. Versus some of them cleanse works, definitely not Malzahar though. Versus the others either heal or ignite if you think you can win the skill matchup. Most of the time their damage spike is enabled when they get their stun and they will output on you huge amounts of magic damage, so if you think you will die before the game starts, think about if you want magic resist and bone plating from the resolve tree or an early magic resist item such as Negatron Cloak. Most of the time you will probably die to a random stun and their jungler, so use vision wards and wards nearby jungle entrances in these matchups especially because they will want to kill you with their jungler. In these matchups, if you don't feel you can win, you can easily roam. Malzahar press 6 is annoying and post 6 is also annoying, but it should not have kill power you until 6. And post 6 you should play safer anyways and push and roam. Lissandra is a rare matchup and is certainly killable with cleanse if you are careful post 6. Cassiopeia might be in top hardest matchups if she is good. She will love to Q and then e-spam you, so your best shot is to dodge first Q. Always dodge ult because it is hugely predictable by her animation. Early on, you can poke her from a distance and keep her at bay. Don't get too close because she will start the e-spam. Watch her mana bar and engage accordingly. Syndra will try to spam you early on, but you can have the edge with your Qs if she mispositions the slightest. If she does the instant E combo, the matchup becomes extremely hard, but until high diamond you should probably be safe. If he does know how to instant stun you, get an early magic resist item and all the defensive stats you can get. Versus Lux, you have to dodge her Q and you are good to go. She will try to push you out of the lane every time she can. Try to dodge as many long range E's as you can and try to keep afloat press 6. Post 6 just roam or try to full engage on her by dodging her Q. and Nivea can be another annoying matchup into Taliyah because of her Q and W potential on ganks. Pre-6 you can out damage her if you dodge Q. If you can dodge her Qs, just play safe. Never go for huge outplays unless you know where all their team members are. Remember her passive and play accordingly. Roam as much as you can. All of these champions would love to stun you for their jungler to reach you. So again, go for cleanse and other defensive stats and items if you think you cannot survive the lane phase and post 6 without extra defensive things. Versus Veigar, you have to understand how his E works and when his main amount of burst will come. Later on, you can go Zhonya to deny his ult damage, ensuring easier teamfights if he casts it on you. Ganks from your jungler won't be easy due to his E, but you can bait it before. Out roam and get killed somewhere else if lane is too hard. In these hard burst matchups, always be extremely cautious when returning to mid lane from a gank, because they will usually wait in a bush in the river. Other matchups such as Vladimir, Viktor, Orianna, Corki, Ahri, Galio, Heimer, Swain, Zilean, Morgana, Ryze, and so on. Versus Vladimir, you should always stay back when his Q is fully charged and you should try to keep up with his push, because a good Vladimir will push you 24/7. Always be careful to his E, Flash, Q combo that a lot of Vladimirs like to do at higher elos. You will not be really able to kill him in lane if he's good because of his W, but if you really want to try to get rid of his W by poking him down, and when you know it is on cooldown, you can call your jungler and go for the kill. Never dive a Vladimir because he can simply outplay you. Get Morello if you feel his heal is too strong. Versus Viktor, you have to learn that laser and dodge it as often as you can. Post 6, he will have kill power on you, so be careful. Try to see how he plays, and if you can win the trace, then keep fighting. If not, go push and roam bot. Orianna can be a difficult matchup if she knows to stay behind minions. Against her, the lane should be mostly even as she does not really have kill power press 6 and your poke should be generally better than hers. Keep lane even and push at 6, but be careful of her ult and jungler ganks when you don't have flash. A good Orianna would want to flash ult on you and your ADC in teamfight, so try to stay away from others and tell them too. Corki is a comparable roamer to you only when he gets his package. Always spam ping on your team when he has it and you will be safe. Don't stray away too far when he has it because he can reach you and maybe outplay you. His damage potential is not huge until he gets 2 or 3 items, so you should be generally safe in lane. Try to kill or out roam. Versus Ahri, all you have to do is to dodge her E pre-6 in order to kill her. Play with cleanse if you think their jungler will reach you if she hits you, and post 6, play careful because of her ult. Galio will get countered by Lyandre now, and I doubt he's still as strong, but be careful when roaming, that he will easily follow your kill target with his ult. Flash or cleanse his taunts if you suspect a gank. Heimerdinger is a rare matchup that you won't be able to outpush. Try to play defensive press 6 and hope for a good shove and roam bot. Beware of his huge kill power with his Q beams. I haven't played much against Swain, but I believe this is another matchup in which Morello can be good. Dodge his kill shots and roam if you don't feel that you can outpower him on lane. Zilean or Morgana are all about their Q stun and push power. You should be careful to those stuns and you are good to go. Right now, Ryze has been pretty nerfed, but if you fight him, try to Q him from a distance and go for the full combo whenever you can. You have better poke and better push power early on until he gets some items, so abuse that accordingly. I'm fairly sure I didn't include some matchups that are even more rare than this, but I will answer any other questions in the comment below anyways. Why play Taliyah? I believe this champion can teach anyone the macros of the game pretty fast, and I also believe she has a good ratio for how challenging she is and what rewards she offers. She can be used for fast climbing solo queue when the player has enough experience on her, and she is extremely satisfying on good wall ultimates or W predicts. I believe she is a well-rounded and designed champion that should not be nerfed or buffed in the current state of the game, and probably until the next season where the new major changes might appear. This champion also teaches you how and when to play safer or more aggressive, especially in the lane phase. It teaches you when you should push or wait, how to spot wards so you don't get caught in roams, how to be more aware of the enemy jungler because if you die twice on lane the game's over. I believe this should be considered as a hard champion that has mostly skill matchups, and like Bard, there's no easy way to understand how to cast your ultimate besides practicing in a lot of games. There's a reason why she has a low win rate for the guys who play her only for 1 to 50 games. from the champion.gg statistics. For the conclusion, I wanna say that I honestly cannot believe I've actually finished this. After writing a script containing more than 9000 words and over 20 pages of advice, I can say I can happily make a final paragraph for this. I really hope this guide made some people start playing Taliyah and others to main her. I hope it gave some insight towards the more advanced players, and I truly hope this is useful for anyone who comes across and likes to learn more about Taliyah. If you made it across through the end, I want to thank you, and even if you watch only parts of it, I'm truly glad you did. I will post video resources right at the end of the clip for those interested in further learning. This video was realized with the information from a lot of Taliyah mains from my own Discord, Reddit Taliyah mains, and also Summoner School and League of Legends. I'm Drewmatth, and I'm really glad you watched this, and I want to thank you so much for watching, and have a nice day.